it's a blank sheet. It's definitely a blank sheet.
Yeah. I mean, it's a blank sheet as far as the story, and the narrative, the plot. It's we know there are certain have to be certain elements in a Bond film that people have come to expect, and of course, those have to be invented too.
Bond impresario Cubby Broccoli handed over a legacy of 17 films to daughter Barbara and stepson Michael Wilson when he died in 1996. Having spent their lives growing up on the Bond sets, Barbara and Michael have been the producers of the James Bond films since GoldenEye. It's May 2001, and the release date of the 20th Bond film is already set for November 2002. Along with writers Neil Purvis and Robert Wade, the producers have been working for almost a year on the new script for Bond 20.
I guess we always start off with, you know, what is the world worried about, or what is the world going to be worried about in the next couple of years? And, you know, what is James Bond's place in that arena?
The process really starts with Michael and Barbara and Neil and myself reminding each other of the things that are great in the novels. That might not have been used.
The thing about Bond is, it's in Dr. No, isn't it, the book? He'd had the poison from Rosa Klebs, and they say that, you know, he's about the only one who could have survived it.
We do always go back to Fleming. I mean, the James Bond character is so complex and multifaceted that you can always tap into some new aspect. And I think with, you know, particularly with Pierce, he has, you know, such great vulnerability and humanity. And I think because of him, we can go into areas that we haven't done before.
Robert Wade and Neil Purvis came to the attention of the producers during their search for new screenwriters to tackle the 19th Bond film, The World Is Not Enough. Controlling the destiny of James Bond is not a bad way to earn a living, but the reality can be far less glamorous.
It is about sitting in a stuffy room for endlessly, isn't it?
Well, sitting around a table with Michael and Barbara day in, day out, and hammering out a structure. And then Rob and I sit in separate cafes, and you do your work, and we discuss it on the phone, and then you individually go to separate pubs to calm down after the amount of coffee that you've had. So that's just scientific that you have to do that. But we have certain pubs that, you know, we have not come up with ideas in that we don't go to.
Well, working with the writers is a group effort. We sort of sit down, brainstorm for weeks. We kick ideas around with them, and they're entertaining people. If you have to be locked up with somebody all day long, it might as well be them.
When you get the script, they are so busy just trying to flesh out the story. It's an impressionistic script, so to speak. As you get closer to, and as they get more comfortable with the structure of the story, then you come to what's the character and how does the character really move within it.
But what does M think of that? I mean, M won't make sense of that.
Barbara
discussion.
Never lets us forget about character.
The C word.
Character. Oh, we have to deal with character now?
In between explosions and helicopter, we occasionally try to get a bit of character in.
The draft version of the script they have now will change many times in the coming months. The appointment of a director to the production is certain to incur radical changes as a fresh eye throws up new ideas.
It'll be interesting to see what the arrival of the director will do in terms of this story, because we've got a pretty worked out story and it could be pushed in certain directions a bit more, and that's what's going to happen next, I guess.
After a lengthy search, the producers finally announced that Lee Tamahori is to direct Bond 20. Tamahori's recent run of success in Hollywood is thanks in no small part to a low-budget film he made in his native New Zealand in 1994. Once Were Warriors won international acclaim for its frank and shocking depiction of inner-city family life.
Once Were Warriors is a potpourri of everything that people don't want to go to the movies for. You want to go and be entertained, so I was testing myself. So I went and did that, but not ever in the expectation that it would do what it did, which was basically end me up directing a Bond movie.
We start off wanting to find a filmmaker, you know, somebody who's a real filmmaker, someone who can get their head around the enormity of the whole franchise. Lee's body of work was just so astounding. I mean, Once We're Warriors is like one of the greatest films, I think, that's been made in the last 50 years.
The details concern me, because the devil is always in the damn details.
We're in a kind of mad stage of scrambling to get the script together, because that's the blueprint we need for everything.
Tony Wei is the executive producer and is responsible for budgeting, scheduling, and crewing the film.
This morning is quite an important first meeting on Bond 20. It's the first time that we're getting the director, the second unit director, the special effects supervisor, the model unit supervisor, and Peter Lamont and the art department together to discuss the action sequences.
So I want to do the car chase like a Battle of Britain. It's a Messerschmitt and Spitfire battle. You know, the chase.
It is a pretty seamless operation. And what you do is, I think for all of us, as solo directors that drop in, it can be quite unnerving. And so you do approach it with a certain amount of suspicion in the beginning, because what we don't want is a kind of like, oh, this is how we do the Bond movies. You'll just come along with us and do it like that.
What about the ground? How are we going to treat the ground for the car?
It freezes up, we know. It's good when it freezes up, all the icebergs stay solid, so we're then dealing with a known quantity. Nobody's done it before on that lake.
I think we're starting to go into a good direction now. You know, I was a bit worried about the lack of an opening sequence, but I can see that in my head now. It's just getting the variables into it. The ice will be fun. It's not going to be without its problems. I think it'll be a bigger problem than the boat chase on the Thames, though, shooting those type of cars on ice.
Where do you see the main problems at the moment?
It's all conceptual at the moment, because the action is so huge and so massive. Any one of these would be the centerpiece of another movie, but we've got about five of them. I'm sitting here with Martin Asbury, and we're starting to go through storyboards at the moment, starting to put these ideas into a visual form, which everyone can then start looking at, seeing how we resolve them.
My job really is to suggest things and also to get inside the director's head, find out his preconceptions, and try and put on paper in visual form what he wants the film to look like.
I mean, have you ever seen your scene that you sort of developed in your head that kind of was never changed and ended up on the screen?
Yes, once or twice, yes. Which was exciting and rewarding, being a backroom boy. Very often, you know, when it's all locked down and they've got the storyboard they want, when they go on the set and they shoot it, they find it's not possible, they don't like what they're doing, and it'll change. And then I cry.
Because, of course, it's all your fault, that.
Yeah, oh, absolutely, yes, of course.
With only 4 months to go before shooting begins, the special effects department and Bond have more than their fair share of work ahead of them. Special effects supervisor Chris Corbould is quick to point out that there's more to his department than just blowing things up.
You got the smoke, the wind, rain, snow, and explosions are the obvious thing, and then you go to special vehicles, I suppose, is probably the best way of describing it, which is any adaptions to vehicles to obtain certain events in the sequence.
The Aston Martin was synonymous with Bond films throughout the 60s and 70s. For the 20th Bond, the producers thought it was time to bring it back. A high-speed chase in an ice lake is scripted. The first of many requirements for the cars is to convert them all to four-wheel drive.
What will have to happen is all of that will have to go, have to lose that V12, takes up too much space, put in the V8 and push it way back so we can get our second axle up here, leaving all of this space free. For the weaponry and everything else.
One thing the Bonds have always been good at is attracting publicity, and rumours are abound long before shooting begins.
Bond publicity?
We have often no idea where these rumours come from. For instance, there was a suggestion that the title would be Beyond the Ice on this film. And we tracked it down to a certain newspaper in May 2000. And that title got used a lot because it had exposure in the UK media, it was then picked up by internet sites and went around the world.
I mean, people tell you what the rumours are. You know, I hear Whitney Houston's going to be in it. Is it true he's going to team up with the IRA?
And also, I think, I mean, now that we've been involved in it for a while, you wouldn't rule anything out. Even though Beyond the Ice has never been the title, you can't rule it out.
In terms of film magazines, you can't really get more important than James Bond. If you put James Bond on your cover, you will sell 30 to 40,000 more issues. I think if it's in the spirit of fun and entertainment, then they tend to run with it, even if it is blatantly false.
After 40 years of Bond, there's this desire to be part of the world's most successful franchise. It's as simple as that.
I think we long ago gave up responding to things because, I mean, it would be a full-time job, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
How many times have we come in on a Monday morning and the director will say to us, God, is this true? You know, or somebody on the crew.
Have we cast so-and-so?
Have we cast so-and-so? And you say, no, of course not.
Well, what have you been meeting secretly with him?
We all, you know, we're all susceptible to believing what we read. I mean, even ourselves.
There was one very spooky time when I was convinced that somebody was going through my rubbish bin or tapping the phone or something, because every person we talked about, suddenly, next week we'd read about it in the paper.
The film's pre-title Hovercraft Chase takes place in the Korean Demilitarized Zone. The Army's tank training ground 30 miles west of the studios provides a perfect match for the terrain. Action Unit Director Vic Armstrong uses the various features of the location to help build a structure for the chase.
Bond goes through the water splash. This sequence is not really in the script as such. We will write the storyline around the location we've got, which is here. Which again is the right way to do it, otherwise you just end up chasing your tail.
Here on the road though, we could get some really cool tracking stuff with you. And if you could make the curve, if not, then cut down and stop. It's a nice long flat run.
As with most Bonds, or with most scripts really, that is sort of open-ended. I can't even remember what's in there because we're expecting a rewrite very soon. So it's just an open-ended plug that's in there for this amount of time in the script.
You know, initially we thought, oh, should we put hovercrafts on wheels and make it easier for ourselves? But it's a very unique look when you look at the way a hovercraft goes along. It sort of slips sideways and, you know, slews round. And I don't think you wouldn't have got that if we put them on wheels.
What you're writing is, it's more serious now because this is what will actually get shot. So, you know, the whole machine starts operating and Lee's off to Iceland and Cuba and we're not. The reasoning is that if we're travelling, we're not writing.
Obviously that's a short-sighted viewpoint.
This picture kind of takes place in North South Korea, Hong Kong, Havana, London. The thing is how to do it. We can lose 2-3 weeks on a schedule just travelling. North Korea, we've recreated back at the studio, which is this set here. We did a sojourn to Havana to have a look at the real Havana, but of course, you know, it's one of those places that we can't really go to. So we're picking that part up in Cadiz.
Filming on location takes months of preparation to set up the infrastructure required to accommodate the massive Bond unit. Key crew members travel to all the proposed locations where Lee outlines his plans for shooting. Any unforeseen problems need to be ironed out at this stage.
I'm not opposed to having, you know, people sitting out here and drinking coffee and doing all that, because that's what they do in Cuba, in Havana as well. Yeah. As long as it's not all...
It's a process of discovery. This becomes the kind of definitive blueprint so that people know what they're building. Now a bunch of carpenters and set construction guys and special effects people know what they're going to do, and we can't really deviate from that because they're going to come back and build all this, and some of it's going to be built before we get back here. So you come back here and it's pretty tricky to change your mind when you come back.
Do we have a lockdown script yet, or is that...
No, we don't. Scripts are always in a state of flux. I would imagine
Other directors on Bond movies would say the same thing, that even as we're shooting this thing, as we're going through it, it'll be changing every day.
So your main focus at the moment, then, is it casting, or are you just keeping a watchful eye?
My main focus is actually to get the story in the right shape, because only if the script is in the right shape can we then go back and then modify sets, take them out, modify the action. As we drop into the casting, it's becoming pretty hair-raising at the moment. I have to now shift focus and move on to casting and pretty much leave this behind at the moment. So anyway, let's take a walk.
As casting director, Debbie McWilliams must submit to the production a selection of actors she thinks suitable for each role. On a film this size, it can involve hundreds of actors from all over the world.
Debbie, how far away from needing actors at the moment?
It's a subject that is a little tricky, as it's apparently in 4 actual working weeks. We haven't cast a single solitary person yet, apart from Dear Pierce and Judy Dench and the regulars. Apart from that, nobody cast at all. Not that we haven't seen a lot of people, we've seen hundreds of people, but either they haven't been appropriate or haven't felt that the time was right to offer the part, and then people become unavailable. It's sort of slightly tricky in that the script has changed quite a bit as well. I mean, it's a sort of organic being, the making of these films.
Today, the press have got hold of the fact that Halle Berry might be involved in in the film. A, is that true? And B, how did they get hold of that information?
Well, we'd like it to be true. She certainly is top of the list, and negotiations have been going on for quite some time. And I'm afraid it was my fault. Apparently, I blurted out to a nice little man in Korea who was helping me out there that I thought she was going to be doing it. And the next thing I knew, it was on the internet. So sorry about that, everybody.
Now, just a word about all these guys. One presumes this, that we get close like this. These are Asian stunt guys. We were wondering, I guess, when we get up there, that even at some point we could even swap stunt drivers for maybe some Asian guy that can get beaten up and thrown out.
I think that's what we do. We guys drive, and for the closest stuff, we use an Asian.
How many have we got? Have we got 2 or 3?
We use both of them.
The production are planning to shoot much of the Korean sequences in the UK. With only 2 qualified Asian stuntmen in the country, Vic Armstrong and stunt coordinator George Aguilar need to explore other avenues to find the considerable amount of stunt performers required for the scenes. They invite martial arts clubs to attend a casting session with the stunt department to see if they've got what it takes.
So we're going to do a scenario. Okay.
George, have these guys got any training at all?
Some have, some don't. And you can tell, you know. Some are naturally good and others are no idea. When you hear, and that's a gunshot, and he's got a high-powered rifle.
Right.
And when you hear that, you fall to the ground dead. And you interpret it however you want. However you want to fall, you fall.
This is for Moon's Compound, a pre-title sequence. We've got all these martial artists in, and as you see, the boys are just polishing up their film skills. I think they're excellent, really good.
Have you worked much with kind of non-stunt people?
Yes. I've worked all over the world, and basically only take your stock company with you, 5-10 guys, and you know, we've done films with 50, 100, 150 guys, so I'm quite used to auditioning all these sort of people all over the world, but it's just having people that have the right theatrical flair for it without being over the top.
Many of the sets are now taking shape, and Lee keeps a constant eye on progress.
Do you still feel you're allowed to put your stamp on it as you would normally on a movie?
To a degree, yes. You can only make it your own movies in so much, but it's a 007 movie. There are a certain set of expectations. It has to look pretty slick. It can't be a dogma movie from Northern Europe. But you do have to be careful with what you do with Bond.
We both go back to what Cubby taught us. And he taught us many, many things. But one of the most important things he said to us, I think, was, don't screw it up. You know, Fleming had created this character. They had created a whole film genre. You know, he used to say, everybody will try and mess with it and screw it up. And your job is to really keep an eye on things. And it sounds very simple, but it's very difficult because you have all different people coming from different areas trying to recreate Bond.
Surf Supremo Laird Hamilton is flown in to meet the production about the opening scene of the movie.
Getting James Bond in the tube is great. He does everything else, he might as well, surf.
Is there a good and a bad time of year to surf?
Well, ironically, December, January, February is the heart of the winter season, and it's the time of the year when the Northern Hemisphere has the biggest storm. So, this is the time. We're coming into the heart of the peak wave season.
You need to actually put a team together. You need to know that they're already there and that they're available next January or something, yes?
Yeah, well, the surfers, we have them.
Right.
They're at our call, right. And we have backup. If somebody has to go and they're doing something else, we have our guys to back
up. It's never difficult to pick up the phone and say you want to go surfing today, right?
Well, it is when it's 25 feet. You usually can't find people. It's like, I'm busy. I think it's taxes. Yeah, I got to do my taxes. It's not like Little Way. It's easy to find the location that we've chosen for this particular shoot is a huge wave on Maui called Jaws. The bottom topography allows these waves to double and triple in size, and some of the biggest waves ever surfed are ridden at this particular location.
It's 5 months since Lee Tamahori took on the monumental task of directing the 20th Bond film. The production is about to shut down for its 2-week Christmas break. On the return, he will have just 1 week before shooting begins.
Every director probably takes this on and worries about the same thing. It's impossible to get into a genre like this where there's been 19 movies that have come before you, and some of them terribly famous and some of them not so famous, but all of them have contributed to a whole. And you can't get into this without thinking that, are you going to be the director that fails, that is going to make the bad Bond movie, or the one that's a real turkey?
According to the weather forecast, perfect surfing conditions were predicted for Christmas Day. Laird scrambles his crew in preparation for the shoot.
The amount of time and experience you need to be able to ride the waves that we've been able to ride, it takes a lifetime. And so it's a religious experience to be in the presence of the power of these waves. On Earth, it's one of the few times that you can really see the power of God.
The proof's in the pudding, but we did our job. So it's in the hands of the directors and the editors now.
It wasn't much of a holiday, really, Christmas, but the script had to be completely sorted out.
I don't think you meant to emphasise the word completely. It just needed a thorough
polish
so that we could issue a new draft. That was it. So there really wasn't any problem.
What happened to Gala Brand?
Originally, we started out thinking in terms of the character who was in the Moonraker novel. In reworking the plot, we felt that she wasn't really Gala Brand anymore. So she became Miranda Frost.
You're a very cool customer, Miss Frost. We'll probably get said at some stage.
And with only 5 days to go before shooting begins, it's announced that young British actress Rosamund Pike will play Miranda Frost. Joining Toby Stevens and Halle Berry is the key cast of Bond 20.
We looked at literally hundreds of people. You know, it was a long, long search. I'd been sent a tape of a film, and I looked at it and I saw her, and I thought, oh, she's interesting. I just knew the minute I saw her that she was the girl for the job.
Had a first initial meeting with Debbie McWilliams. And then I had a meeting with Lee on Monday. And then 2 days later I came to Pinewood and had a screen test. And then 2 days after that, he said yes.
Rosamund took a while to find. We were looking all, it's pretty hard to find pretty girls that can act in Britain. If they're here, they run off to America.
It's pretty daunting to come into these for myself or for anybody. Acting is like that. And that's the great challenge. And she's a lovely person.
I think the whole Bond world just picks you up and doesn't really put you down again. You know, I felt like that. I felt just before Christmas. I was sort of lifted into this new world and, you know, I'm going to live in it for a year or more. Maybe, you know, maybe it stays with you for forever. I don't know.
What about the girl, Miranda Frost? Have you decided on her look yet?
Well, that's a sort of Lindy thing. I mean, that's all, you know, developing as we go. It's all been kind of, I think you're best to talk to Lindy about
and
that.
And Hallie as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
She hasn't been in yet.
They're all now just arriving for fittings, you see. So it's early stages on that, really, to talk
but
about that.
She's in her first scene on Monday.
Oh,
it's
yes.
Thursday today.
Oh, yeah. It's plenty of time.
And you haven't actually designed...
Just keep smiling.
I don't think you're going to be able to use this.
It's Lindy Hemming from the James Bond film.
Are you confident you're in reasonably good shape?
No. We're not in good shape at all. We're in awful shape, really. But we'll get there.
Why are you in awful shape?
Late casting, changes of script. Very, you know, lots of changes of script all the time for the whole period. Because when the script changes, people's story changes, and so suddenly something you might have done would become like nonsensical. And I tend on Bond now, after doing so many of them, to leave things very late because I know that I might waste thousands and thousands of pounds on something that isn't there anymore.
You've got Halle Berry coming tomorrow.
Tomorrow we've got costume maker coming to look at her, to meet her. We've got some drawings to show her, fabrics to show her. Shoes, hundreds of pairs of shoes to show her, and we're going to just get going and start on with her costume.
What's wrong about you?
Historically, the title of the next James Bond film was announced at the end of the previous film.
I thought Christmas only comes once a year.
But by the end of The World Is Not Enough, the next title had not been agreed upon. 2 days before shooting begins on Bond 20, and the question of the title remains unresolved.
The key issue now, which is of course the title.
Well, we've got countless titles.
Yeah.
But it's finding a title that everybody likes is the problem.
If you look at, you know, you come up with a title and then you go and check it out on IMDb and on the internet, and more often than not, it was a TV movie in 1974, which is quite annoying.
But the press conference is tomorrow. So it'll be interesting to see whether a title is announced or not.
You think it might be?
Well, we've got the afternoon to sort it out.
Happy New Year!
Bond has always been about the circus. Bond has always been about the high theatricality of film.
James Bond. Essa sempre foi a marca do famoso agente secreto.
Who's going to be the girls, the gadgets, the locations? Cubby Broccoli set the benchmark all those years back, and Cubby, being the ringmaster, knew how to set up a show and leave the audience wanting more.
Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Here we go again. Bond number 20. XX. No title as yet. If anybody has a bright idea during the proceedings.
So as an actor coming into it, you have to be fully aware. It's many roles you play. You because you have to deal with the media.
It is like somewhat slipping on a pair of old shoes in some respects.
And especially with that character, you have to be strong enough to be able to live with it, probably for the rest of a career.
Bond is big. It's great to see the interest. You know, that just reminds me, you know, of the magnitude of what making a Bond movie is.
Well, I mean, it's quite intimidating, I suppose. It's the first kind of press conference I've ever done like that. You know, I've watched them many times, you know, and just wondered what would that be like. But luckily, I wasn't asked many questions, so I didn't have to kind of say much.
I'm very proud to be here. I grew up watching Bond. You know, it's really hard to talk about right now. We don't know what is waiting and what the experience will be like.
Whilst the main unit got off to a flying start with scenes in MI6 and Q Division, there appears to be trouble ahead in Iceland for the action unit. They're due to film there in a month's time.
You've just come back from Iceland.
Yeah. I think we have to face reality about now that that ice is not going to freeze thick enough to take the vehicles and do the things we need to do. So we've got to face reality and start looking at alternatives. You know, it's almost too late for that now, but we will come up with something. But even it's rethinking the car chase and definitely rethink the location.
The director wants icebergs. We've been trying to find lakes in Sweden. Somebody said there's one in Canada. The director would like to go to New Zealand.
We might also go to Alaska. That's another possibility. We're just working those things out right now.
Hi, yeah, Kenny? Because of the time pressure, whether we go to Alaska or Iceland, we are now going to have to fly the equipment wherever we go. We can't take anything by ship at the moment. As we did on The World Is Not Enough, we didn't let any old mealy-mouthed Welsh minister stop us filming on the Thames, and we're not going to let a fact that the ice lake's not frozen stop us on this.
Production office.
We have to face facts that Iceland probably isn't going to freeze, isn't that
the kind of defeatist attitude we want, Rob? No. We're going to keep our options open all the time. We're keeping our fingers crossed that the opening into the lake, the saltwater lake in Iceland, if that freezes, that gives us a fighting chance that we could get the ice thick enough to film on next year. Now, that obviously isn't going to help us this year.
So Alaska's now confirmed?
Alaska's not confirmed at this time because it's expensive and we don't officially have the permit and we don't have work permits for the crew. Iceland, currently the ice is not thick enough and the chances are, although it's freezing, it's possibly 8 or 9 inches thick, but we need 24 inches. And the chances of that happening in the next week or two is unlikely.
Vic Armstrong and the action unit concern themselves with the hovercraft chase, which will form part of the pre-title sequence.
Oh, it's great to be out and about. Pinewood gets a bit kind of cramped after a while.
But just 5 weeks into a 6-month shooting schedule, the production is hit with the worst news of all.
What's the current situation with Piers?
Well, he's been injured on one of the sets and while he was doing an action sequence. So he'll be going out to California and having an operation on his knee, and he should be back with us by the beginning of March.
I was gutted. It's an athletic part, and if you like being in the fray, you know, suddenly you have to do a 150-yard dash through a Korean landscape and jump on a moving hovercraft, and bingo.
We have never, on a Bond, stopped shooting, ever. And we stopped shooting for 7 days.
Production's gonna close down because of me. I'm trying to deal with that because, you know, you feel guilt. I've blown it here.
Over the last 2 weeks, things have complicated further for Vic Armstrong in Iceland. costs for shooting in Alaska are spiraling out of control, whilst the lake in Iceland still shows no sign of freezing to an acceptable thickness.
Now we're thinking of going back to Iceland. We're searching other lakes in Iceland, but today is Wednesday. Come Monday, the ship has to leave with everything you're going to take out there, so somebody has to make a decision soon as to, you know, whether we're going to send it or not.
The local Icelandic crew had told the production of a method they had used in the past to encourage the ice to thicken. They would need the right weather conditions, and even then it wasn't guaranteed. But it was worth a try.
The worst thing for the ice is we got sea flooding 2 times a day, and if the sea around here is 5 to 7 degrees centigrade, so it was melting always the ice from underneath. I got 2 bulldozers, one heavy machine to feed the bulldozers, and then we just started building from each side. And when the tide came in, it was a quiet moment, then we closed the gap. And now it's getting thicker and thicker by the day.
As it turned out, we were blessed with just an unusually low temperatures that froze the ice. The guys are up there at the moment shooting fantastic stuff, unbelievable stuff. I've never seen anything like it.
Start over there and run this way, so this is behind us. This is the backdrop, yeah?
If the weather stayed as it is now, this sun and lack of wind, we'd be finished in 3 days, I think.
Back at Pinewood, the week gets off to a good start with 2 members of the crew returning victorious from Hollywood's glitzy Oscar ceremony. Halle Berry beats fellow Bond cast member Judi Dench to the Best Actress Award for her role in Monsters Ball. And earlier in the evening, she presented the Best Sound Award to production sound mixer Chris Monroe for his work on Ridley Scott's film Black Hawk Down.
It was nerve-wracking. Absolutely nerve-wracking.
Really?
It was great. Of course, Halle must have, of course, known that she was going to be presenting the sound Oscar, but I didn't know that.
We're just surprised. I knew I was giving out your category, and I didn't want to tell you. I can hardly say the other 2 names. I was like,
one of the best things is that the very next day I had to fly back to London and resume working on Bond. And it was such a reality check for me, and it was a wonderful reality because I come back to a great movie and I got right back into what life of an actor is really all about, and it's about the work. And it's not really about those moments where you get accolades, it's about the moments when you're doing the work that allows you to even stand up there for 4 minutes in my case, and accept an award.
We wanted to find a title that had some Fleming resonance to it, particularly because, you know, it's the 20th film, the 40th anniversary. So it was a struggle to come up with something that sounded like a Fleming title.
It's not a play on an old phrase. You know? That's something that Fleming did as one of the devices he used.
Cadiz, in southwest Spain. The unit arrived to typical Andalusian sunshine to shoot the vibrant Cuban scenes. A welcome relief from the British winter the unit have just endured. But the crew had barely unpacked their shorts before conditions deteriorated.
It has been really cold, and I've been wet in all of my scenes in a little sundress and barefoot, and it's been a little chilly. You know, that's part of it. That's part of the movie. I remember Lee looked at me one day and he said, "This is what you wanted to do, darling. You signed up." And I said, "Yes, I did, and I love it."
It's a little bit chilly. Yeah.
I've been hamming it up with the hot water bottles. It's pretty pathetic, really. With a big fluffy blue dressing gown on and a pink hot water bottle. It's not very Bond.
Slightly worse on. The 5 forecasts we've had this morning are all the same. A lot of rain, thunderstorms, just a pretty depressing picture for Spain.
in mid-April.
This is one of the worst series of storms on record. We're thinking about wrapping early on this location and going back to Pinewood. We've had battled it rain, wind, and cloud cover for the past 5 days. And there's no end in sight, according to the weather reports.
This is from the military just across the water. This is more accurate, but it looks horrible, doesn't it?
The major scene of Halley coming out of the sea. Probably going to have to recreate on the paddock tank at Pinewood. So it's quite a blow. We've never had this happen to us on all the 9 bonds I've been on. Never had to abandon a location because of weather.
It's all a bit sad.
Really?
Yeah. I'm going to cut our losses, go on Wednesday.
Yeah.
And then they'll figure out whether to come back here or do it on the back lot.
I guess.
There you go.
Day 6 of the Spanish shoot, and against all the odds, it seems the weathermen were wrong. The unit take to the streets.
We've had 5 days of hell, and this is our first day of sunshine. But it's kind of worth it for this, because this is a big scene, big Cuban street scene, and as you can see, the weather turned out, and so did the crowd, and it looks fantastic.
Spirits were so down last week. Things have looked up, the weather has changed, and I think the gods are with us. So I think we're going to be here tomorrow. I think we'll get Halley's scene. This is her big scene and her entrance into the movie, so spirits are good.
This is supposed to rival Ursula Andress, and I don't know. I don't know if I can do that.
There's been a great deal of anticipation. Hot anticipation. No wonder. I think she's got the most fantastic figure for a bikini that you could ever have, really. Diamonds are forever. There was the situation which we all wanted, I think, which was an homage to the Ursula Andress bikini. And we've come up with this electric orange, very revealing and sexy bikini. And a very, very beautifully crafted diving belt, which fits exactly on the top of her hips.
That's good, Halley.
Diamonds are forever, sparkling round my little finger. Unlike men, the diamonds linger. Men are mere mortals who are not worth going to your grave for.
Disaster hits the unit yet again, as a second cast member sustains an injury. Fortunately for Halley, and the production, it's not actually true. Just one more over-exuberance on the part of the press.
It's totally ridiculous, the press that's happened about this eye. It was nothing, really. We were shooting a scene where there was a little gunfire and a little dust got in my eye, and a thread of truth gets out, and then the media just takes it, and it becomes a monster. And it was really, really nothing.
Behind the calm exterior of the Pinewood stages lurks the special effects team, who have begun to systematically destroy some of the larger Bond sets. Months of explosives testing and refining have gone into preparing for this one shot. The special effects team have spent over 2 weeks rigging the explosives. This will be the biggest bang of the movie. The unit rehearse it, and rehearse it.
Another rehearsal.
Nothing is left to chance.
Well, you probably all know this, but there's a series of 70 explosions here.
With these people, with Chris and the special effects, it's phenomenal what they do. because they've got everyone's lives in the palm of their hands, so to speak. And that takes great concentration, great preparation, and guts.
Once action has been called, there is no stopping, there's no cutting. We've got to keep going. Because if somebody doesn't hear the cut, who's firing bangs or whatever, that's when the situation gets dangerous.
There are too many things that can possibly be a risk. You have to try and eliminate every single one of them if you can.
And do keep an eye out for each other, just in case anybody does twist an ankle or go down, because you're not going to be able to stop it. So try and help each other.
So here we go, guys, stand by.
You always get one of these big ones in a bond. You know, the last one we had, the big one out in Spain. But this was nicer. There's more elements to it. There's every single element of explosion: dust, water, petrol. It was a nice combination, nice cocktail.
But there was one casualty. Camera 7.
Remember that one we dropped in the Thames?
Yeah.
That came up. That was all right, wasn't it? A bit cleaner, that'd be all right, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I don't know.
A couple of new cables.
It's usually those sort of impossible things to do full size, or sometimes it's just the situations where you know you could get a bigger or better effect.
Well, we go back over the first edge there, that's quarter full size. Then we go back to eighth full size to the next level, and then we've blended back into 12th scale, and then back to 16th and 24th, and then we have a painted backing beyond that.
And only when they've got it absolutely right that they blow the whole lot to smithereens. The skills required to be a Bond director are many and varied. But according to Pierce Brosnan, there's only one real essential.
Balls. You gotta have balls if you're gonna direct one of these. And you gotta really be a warrior. I mean, you have to work on many levels, and you have to deal with maybe 3, 4, 5 units going at the same time.
As the production enters the final month of shooting, 7 separate units are now filming simultaneously in a race to get finished on time. With the film release date locked at November 20th, and at least 4 months of post-production scheduled, Lee needs to remain focused to make sure he has every shot he needs in the edit suite.
We're trying to get everything in the can before we go. You can't go back bleating for some more time because it's more expensive to set up another shoot afterwards to pick up shots.
The actors involved in the Blade sword-fighting scene, Pierce, Rosamund and Toby, have been training since January. The scene was due to be shot in March, but Pierce's knee injury forced the production to reschedule. It's now the last remaining scene of the film to be shot.
This film's good for me. This is really good because all the actors pick up swordplay very quickly.
It's real physical work, isn't it?
It is real physical work, yes.
I mean, it's not stunt men. I mean, you're actually out there
doing it. We will be doing it. These guys will be redundant. Hopefully. You are?
Oh, no.
There's no shortcut to excellence. It means training. And I demand a lot of training from the actors, the stuntmen, and anyone else.
We've got now the fencing sequences, and I want them to come alive.
Mm.
And they'll only come alive by your contribution.
As far as possible, when I can, I will train the actors to a standard where they don't need doubling.
Now, I suspect, with all this palaver going on, that should be a cut.
I really do.
Well, it's pretty simple. The next moves around here.
Right.
I mean, I think we remember.
There's no doubt that all of us were surprised by Blades. None of us were sure whether the actors could get up there and fence and do the sword fight. When we got to shooting it, both Pierce and Toby ended up doing most of this thing themselves, and most of us were astonished and stunned to see, I would say 90% of that is being done by the two actors.
It's great for a start, just to kind of get rid of it, you know what I mean? Because, I mean, I'm sick of practicing it. I'm slightly cheesed off that Pierce, who hardly came in, has just picked it up as we've gone along. I mean, he's brilliant. He's just kind of got on with it, and I've been practicing it for months.
They're like tigers there, or dogs kind of chasing each other's tails. They're really going for it.
And cut it.
Jesus Christ. Excellent.
Very good.
Yes, very good.
Ticket, please.
I don't know how I'll go back and make a small movie after this, but somehow I've got to, and I've got to get back to reality somehow.